So guys, the topic that we decided for today is something that we usually don't discuss in class too much about it. We are so much engaged in discussing the neural anatomy and basically concentrating on the central nervous system. So we are kind of stuck in the cerebrum and cerebellum and even the spinal cord, we talk about tracts. So the topic which is at times neglected is the sympathetic chain and the connection of the sympathetic chain to the spinal nerve. What I've seen recently, that there have been questions about, in AIIMS they asked this question about the ramus communicans, the gray and the white ramus communicans. And today's session target is to actually understand that what exactly is white and the gray ramus communicans, how they are connected to sympathetic chain, what are the possible type of fibers running through them, which column they comes under, and some variations also in there, right? So without a further ado, let's get started. So what you're looking at right now here is that you're looking at a transverse section of a spinal cord. Obviously, there's a dorsal and the ventral can be seen on this side. That's a dorsal here and this is the ventral. So you can appreciate this dorsal horn of the spinal cord. This here is the ventral horn. And here we have the lateral horn. As we know, that lateral horn of spinal cord is not present everywhere. Lateral horn can be seen only in the region where the spinal cord need to give the preganglionic sympathetic or parasympathetic neuron. So it's either in the thoracolumbar region or in the sacral region where you'll find these lateral horns. Otherwise, spinal cord is just having the dorsal and the ventral horn. In this lateral horn, we have a set of nuclei present here. We simply call it the lateral horn nuclei. Although we have two parts of lateral horn nuclei called as a intermediolateral, intermediomedial, but we don't have to go into that detail. This nuclei here is the lateral horn nuclei. This is a lateral horn nuclei, and needless to say, this lateral horn nuclei is autonomic, so it will give rise to the sympathetic as well as the parasympathetic neurons. The preganglionic sympathetic or parasympathetic neuron depends upon where we are looking at. Well, today we are discussing about the sympathetic chain, so we are just focusing on the lateral horn nuclei, which are in the sympathetic region. And what is the sympathetic region? When we say sympathetic outflow, I'm sure you all heard of the term sympathetic outflow. Guys, sympathetic outflow, it refers to the thoracolumbar outflow. Sympathetic outflow is a thoracolumbar outflow. We know that craniosacral outflow is a parasympathetic nervous system. That's a parasympathetic nerves coming out from the cranium and the sacral region. And sympathetic nerves, they come out from the thoracolumbar region, the thoracolumbar outflow. And this thoracolumbar outflow, it extends from T1 to L2. It can be L3 also, but usually it's still L2. So from first thoracic nerve to the second lumbar nerve, the nerves which are coming out from this region are the one which are forming preganglionic sympathetic neurons. They are the one which will form preganglionic sympathetic neurons. So that's one thing, that whatever we'll discuss today, the preganglionic nerve will be coming out only from this T1 to L2 region. Although these preganglionic nerve and the postganglionic nerve coming out of this sympathetic chain will be having the different destinations. Okay, so before we go to sympathetic outflow, now as you can see, this here obviously is the dorsal root of the spinal nerve, and this one here is the ventral root. And as you can see, the dorsal and ventral root, they fuse and they form a spinal nerve over there. And along with the dorsal root, you can also appreciate this dorsal root ganglia. That's a dorsal root ganglia. You know, dorsal root ganglia is holding those pseudo unipolar neurons for the nerves which are carrying the sensation in toward the spinal cord. So they make their pseudo unipolar neuron here in the dorsal root ganglia, and then they finally go into the dorsal horn. Like pseudo unipolar neuron in central nervous system were present only in mesencephalic nucleus. But pseudo unipolar neurons, they are present at various locations when we talk about peripheral nervous system. In peripheral nervous system, like even trigeminal ganglion, geniculate ganglion, you know, dorsal root ganglia, they all have pseudo unipolar neurons. So this is one of the site of pseudo unipolar neuron, that is dorsal root ganglia. Then what you see, this dorsal root and the ventral root, when they fuse with each other, they form this spinal nerve. And this spinal nerve is seen connected to this sympathetic ganglion. It's connected to the sympathetic ganglion. And it is connected to sympathetic ganglion by these two roots, one this one and this one. The one which is proximal, the one which is closer to the spinal cord, is called as the gray ramus communicans. This is the one which is called as a gray ramus communicans. Let's call it GRC from now. Gray ramus communicans. And the one which is more distally placed is called as the white ramus communicans. Let's call it WRC. Gray ramus communicans and white ramus communicans. Now, the thing is, the white ramus communicans and gray ramus communicans, the name is given based on the myelination and non-myelination. When you say white ramus communicans, then this is the root which is having mainly the myelinated neurons are there. Myelinated axons are present there. And the gray ramus communicans is the one which is having the non-myelinated axons. It's having the non-myelinated axons. But it's not that simple, guys. Myelinated axon doesn't mean that the white ramus communicans is only having this myelinated axon. We call it white ramus communicans because of that myelin sheath giving it a more of a whitish appearance. But this myelinated axons are way more than non-myelinated here. That means in the white ramus communicans, that's an important thing, that in white ramus communicans, we not only have the myelinated axons, we do have some non-myelinated axons as well. And where they're coming from, we will discuss that in a while. So first we need to look at the anatomical location of the ganglion, then how it is connected to spinal nerve, and then we can talk about that what nerve fibers are running into it. So this is what, that we have a spinal nerve which is connected to the sympathetic chain, the ganglion of the sympathetic chain, by the two roots. The proximal one is a gray ramus and the one which is distal is called as a white ramus communicans. And just for the memory's sake, if I ask you this, remember this G and W. Well, G, gray ramus communicans, W is white ramus communicans. So from W you can remember the welcome, and G is for go. Welcome and go. Just a way to remember it. Like in the ganglion, in the sympathetic ganglion, the root which is welcoming the axon inside, the one which is allowing the axon to come inside the ganglion, they are the W, that is white ramus communicans. And the one which will leave the ganglion will go through G, go, that is gray ramus communicans. Now there are certain possibilities that we have to look into. But before we look into what are the possibilities, that what are the kind of fibers in present in white and the gray ramus communicans, and what variations you have in sympathetic chain, we should know a bit about sympathetic chain. Number of sympathetic ganglion is not corresponding to the number of spinal segments that we have. So guys, when we talk about the number of sympathetic ganglion, number of sympathetic ganglion in sympathetic chain. We do have a sympathetic ganglion apart from the chain also. We have a paravertebral ganglion. But I'm talking about the sympathetic ganglion which are present in sympathetic chain. There are approximately 21 to 22 pairs. So we have around 21 to 22 pairs of the sympathetic ganglia. Out of which, cervical region, we have 3 ganglion. The superior cervical, middle cervical, and inferior cervical. And usually this inferior cervical ganglion is fused with the first thoracic ganglion to form the stellate ganglion. That's a very, very common finding, that the inferior cervical ganglion and the first thoracic ganglion, they are fused and they form a single ganglion called the stellate ganglion. You must have heard about the stellate ganglion in stellate ganglion block also. Then after that, we got a thoracic ganglion. Guys, the number of thoracic ganglion, it is around 11. In the lumbar region, the lumbar ganglion, they are around 4. And sacral, it's around 4 to 5. They're around 4 to 5 ganglion in the sacral region. So that's the number of sympathetic ganglion which are connected by the chain, so-called a sympathetic chain here. So one thing is quite clear, that sympathetic number of sympathetic ganglion in the chain is definitely not corresponding to the number of spinal segment. And it is not even corresponding to the thoracolumbar outflow. Well, thoracolumbar outflow is from T1 to L2. That means we are talking about 14 nerves, isn't it? 12 thoracic nerve and 2 lumbar nerve. But that doesn't mean we only have the 12 sympathetic chain. We have way more sympathetic ganglion in the chain over there. So what is the purpose of having these many ganglions, and where they will get the fibers from? Let's talk about that here. So as I said, with this sympathetic ganglion, we have some possible scenarios. So I'll use a different diagram to make you understand those. And then we'll have a quick recap also in the end. Okay, guys, the scenario number one is that, as we already said, we have the preganglionic sympathetic neuron will start from the lateral horn. So that's a lateral horn nuclei from where the preganglionic sympathetic neuron will begin. And this preganglionic sympathetic neuron will take the ventral root to come out, will go to the distal connection, that is a white ramus communicans, enters the sympathetic chain and will relay there. Let me just write in short here. This is W, that is white ramus, and this is G, that is gray ramus communicans. So what you're looking at here is these are preganglionic sympathetic neuron. That's a preganglionic sympathetic neuron which is coming and relaying into this sympathetic chain. But remember that through the distal connection, that is through the white ramus communicans. So that means it is, they are obviously, they're myelinated here. These are all myelinated. I'm just writing MY for the myelinated. The postganglionic, so first possible scenario is that postganglionic sympathetic neurons, they will go out through gray ramus communicans, join the same spinal nerve, and then will exit through the spinal nerve. As we know, that spinal nerve will further divide into the dorsal and the ventral primary rami. So they will take the root of both dorsal and ventral primary rami, and ultimately going to supply like smooth muscles of blood vessels. They supply the smooth muscles of blood vessel. They do supply the muscles like erector pili muscle. Erector pili. And they also supply the sweat gland. So that's one scenario you're looking at, then where the postganglionic sympathetic neuron is coming out through the gray ramus communicans. So obviously this gray ramus communicans is having the postganglionic sympathetic neuron, which is non-myelinated. That's why we said gray ramus communicans. We do have a non-myelinated axons there. And they are coming out through the same spinal nerve, and they're going to supply the smooth muscles of the blood vessel, the erector pylorum muscle, and the sweat glands. So that's, guys, that's one possible scenario here. And because they're going to supply the smooth muscles, they're going to supply the sweat glands. So obviously, this will come under which column? This comes under the general visceral efferent column. We usually talk about these columns in the brainstem when we talk about cranial nerves. We say GVE, GVA, SVE and all that. General visceral efferent, if you remember, general visceral efferent column in the brainstem is the one which is having all parasympathetic nuclei. Edinger-Westphal nucleus, superior salivatory, inferior salivatory nucleus, dorsal nucleus of vagus. Similarly, GVE column here, the GVE column is represented by these nerves also, which are sympathetic nerve, because they are also going to supply the smooth muscles and the glands. So whether it is brainstem or its spinal cord, if you see a nerve is going to supply the smooth muscles and glands, then obviously it comes under the GVE column, general visceral efferent column, general visceral efferent. So that is case number one. That is case number one. Now see, what is the second scenario, guys? What is the second case scenario is that, now look at, I'm using another diagram for this. Once again, from this lateral horn nuclei, we have preganglionic sympathetic neuron coming out through this ventral root. And they will take again this white ramus communicans thing here, that will enter through the white ramus communicans. And imagine, without relaying into the sympathetic chain, they are simply coming out. And then they're going to relay in one of the paravertebral ganglion. One of the paravertebral ganglion. You must be knowing about the paravertebral ganglion, like celiac ganglion, aortico-renal ganglion. They are present in relation to the aorta, so we call it paravertebral ganglion. I'll take one example here. Let's say the celiac ganglion. So once again, I can say that white ramus communicans, this is gray, white ramus communicans is having preganglionic sympathetic neuron. No question about that. So nothing has changed. This again is a preganglionic sympathetic neuron is there, which is myelinated. This is myelinated. And that is entering into the sympathetic chain through white ramus communicans. But the point is, they are not relaying into the sympathetic chain. They exit the sympathetic chain, and they will find their own ganglion close to the viscera or close to the aorta. Those are paravertebral ganglion. Like one example is a celiac ganglion. So what I'm looking at, that even though these nerve fibers, they are coming out of the sympathetic chain, but they're still pre-ganglionic. So it doesn't mean that if you're looking at a nerve fiber coming out of sympathetic chain, then it is always post-ganglionic. No, it's not necessary. This one is still which? It is still pre-ganglionic. It is pre-ganglionic sympathetic neuron that you're looking at coming out of sympathetic chain, and they are the one which forms the splanchnic nerves. They form the splanchnic nerves. You all must have heard of these splanchnic nerves, the greater splanchnic, lesser splanchnic, least splanchnic nerve. So when you look at these splanchnic nerves coming out from this thoracic region of the sympathetic chain, they are coming out of the sympathetic chain directly. So this gives an indication, okay, they must be post-ganglionic, but they're not. They're still pre-ganglionic sympathetic neurons, and they pierce the crust of the diaphragm, they reach the abdominal region, and they find their own ganglion in that region. And that is like celiac or aortic or renal ganglion. And from that ganglion, the post-ganglionic fibers will begin, and they are the one which are going to supply the viscera, let's say the stomach or duodenum or whatever. So that's a second scenario you're looking at, that you may have a fibers running in the white ramus communicans which relay into the sympathetic chain. You may have a fibers running from the white ramus communicans which exit the sympathetic chain and relay in the ganglion which are like away from that. They are paravertebral ganglion, and then post-ganglionic fibers will reach the viscera. Third scenario. But before I discuss this third scenario with you, now we are only talking about the efferent, guys. We're talking about that the nerve fibers are going out. What about afferent fibers? Now, we'll be having the two types of sensation coming into the spinal nerve. One coming from the body wall, that is general somatic sensation, like general somatic afferent, and sensation from the viscera also, general visceral afferent, the general sensation from the viscera. If the sensation is coming from the somatic structures, if it is coming from the somatic structures, that is from the skin or muscle, then they have nothing to do with the ganglion. What I'm saying is, if let's say I'm talking about the general sensation, just an example, general sensation from skin. Now that general sensation from skin, which could be pain also, that general sensation from the skin, which comes under GSA column, general somatic afferent. It's a general sensation coming from body wall, so it comes under GSA, general somatic afferent. Now what do you see? That these sensation will enter into the spinal nerve, have nothing to do with the white and the gray ramus communicans, will go to the dorsal root ganglia where they have their pseudo unipolar neuron, will use the dorsal root and enter into the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. I'm just drawing these arrows so that you remember that it is the afferent I'm talking about, general somatic afferent. The sensation coming from the somatic structure could be skin, dermis, muscle, like, so all those sensation coming in, they have nothing to do with the white and the gray ramus communicans. So we can leave it up. So we do not have any GSA fibers in the sympathetic chain. But what about those sensations which are coming from the viscera, like general visceral afferent, general sensation from the, let's say, stomach, like the feeling of distension of stomach, or the pain fibers coming from the heart. So they are the one, because they are coming from the visceral organ, so they have to go through the sympathetic chain. So GSA has nothing to do with the sympathetic chain, but GVA will have a say to the sympathetic chain. So let us understand what GVA will do. Let me take another diagram here. Now we are talking about the GVA fiber, guys. That is general visceral afferent. That is general sensation from viscera. Now if I talk about the general sensation from viscera, that obviously comes under the GVA. That comes under this GVA, general visceral afferent. Now these GVA fibers, if I see it in this direction, they will, what you're going to see is that they will enter into the sympathetic chain actually through gray ramus communicans, will use the white ramus communicans, then use this spinal nerve, have their pseudo unipolar neuron in dorsal root ganglia, and ultimately going to relay into the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. So what do you see here this time? Although these fibers are not relaying into what? They are not relaying into the sympathetic chain, but they are connected to sympathetic chain. So if the sensation is coming from the somatic structure, it is simply bypassing the ganglion and going directly into the dorsal horn. But if it is coming from the viscera, that will enter through the gray ramus communicans. Look at that. Enters through the gray ramus communicans And then those fibers, they enter toward the spinal cord through the white ramus communicans, will have their pseudo unipolar neuron present in the dorsal root ganglia and ultimately goes into the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. So I can say that GVA fibers are the one which are having a connection to the sympathetic chain. So till now what we saw that GVE and GVA, these are the two types of fibers that you expect to see in the sympathetic chain. GVE and GVA are the two types of fiber that we expect to see in the sympathetic chain. Okay, now another thing to understand here that these GVA fiber, the one which are carrying these are actually non-myelinated fibers. These are non-myelinated fibers. Like pain fibers are carried by the C fibers, that is, they are non-myelinated fibers. So I can see these non-myelinated fibers are passing from where also? They are passing from the white ramus communicans. And that is why we said in the beginning that white ramus communicans, predominantly it is having the, myelinated exons, but it is also having some non-myelinated exons like the one which are coming from the viscera carrying the general sensation from the viscera. That is another possible scenario for the white and the gray ramus communicans. And finally, guys, one more thing. Now, sympathetic chain, what's the advantage of having a chain? Why can't we simply have the sympathetic ganglion present along the T1, T2, T3, but they're all connected to each other. They are connected to each other because the preganglionic nerve, when it enters the sympathetic chain, it can always go up and down and it can come out from the different level also. Like cervical region of the spinal cord is not sympathetic. Sacral region of spinal cord or the lumbar region, lower lumbar region of spinal cord is not sympathetic. But we still need sympathetic supply in those regions. So these preganglionic sympathetic neuron can enter the sympathetic chain and then they can ascend upward and they can descend downward and can come out from the different level. So one thing which I want to you to understand from this, now look at this picture. This is the one which is shown with the sympathetic chain. So I'm looking at more than one ganglion here. So what I'm talking about here, guys, there is a possibility that the fibers, the preganglionic sympathetic neurons, once again coming out from this ventral root, same story again, they will enter through this white ramus communicans into the sympathetic chain. They relay here. Once again, that's a white ramus communicans. One chance was that they will come out of the gray ramus communicans, and they might end there, and the postganglionic fibers will come out. Now, that was one scenario that they will go like this and will go through this gray ramus communicans. But as I said, there also is a chance that this preganglionic sympathetic neurons, few of these preganglionic sympathetic neurons, instead of relaying there, they will continue their journey in the sympathetic chain and reach in the ganglion which is above. Let's say superior cervical ganglion. And then from this superior cervical ganglion, if I just take an example, guys, it's an example only. Let us say if this is a superior cervical ganglion here, I'm just writing SCG, superior cervical ganglion. From this superior cervical ganglion, the postganglionic sympathetic neuron will again come out, and then the same story will go out and supply the smooth muscles and glands. And obviously to come out, which ramus is needed? This has to be the gray ramus communicans. Now this tells me one very, very important point to understand here. That guys, when you say white ramus communicans, the white ramus communicans cannot be present everywhere. White ramus communicans is the point from where the preganglionic sympathetic nerve enters inside. Getting my point? So that means you cannot have the preganglionic sympathetic nerve everywhere. We only have them in T1 to L2 region. So that is why white ramus communicans, this white ramus communicans is present only between T1 to L2 region. But gray ramus communicans is the one which is the exit from the sympathetic chain. So wherever you have a sympathetic chain, you obviously will have an exit pathway there. Entry pathway is only from T1 to L2, but exit pathway is present everywhere because the postganglionic fiber has to go out and supply the effector organ. That's why the gray ramus communicans is present throughout the extent. They're present throughout the extent, throughout the sympathetic chain they are present. So we have gray ramus communicans everywhere, but white ramus communicans are present only in T1 to L2 region where the preganglionic nerve has to enter inside. So this is a short discussion about that, what exactly the white and the gray ramus communicans is and what type of fibers are seen inside. Let me have a very quick recap before we wrap it up. As we said, this is just a the first time we are doing this live session here, so I just took a very small topic, and if it goes fine, if you like it, we can have more of these sessions in the future as well. So there we go, guys. Let's have a very quick recap here for the people who joined in late. So what we're looking at here, we're looking at a section of a spinal cord where you can see the dorsal root and the ventral root. Let me just keep highlighting them. That's the dorsal and the ventral root. And we do have this lateral horn nuclei present in the region where we have cell bodies of sympathetic or parasympathetic neurons. Talking about sympathetic outflow comes from T1 to L2. So we are looking at these lateral horn nuclei in the region of first thoracic nerve till the second lumbar nerve. It could be L3 also. What you see, the spinal nerve is connected to the sympathetic chain or the sympathetic ganglion by two. The distal one is called as a white ramus communicans, and the proximal one is called as a gray ramus communicans. The white, because of the myelination, we call it white ramus communicans, but it is predominantly myelinated, but not, it's not that it is only having the myelinated exon, it is having the non-myelinated exons also. Gray ramus communicans is essentially having the non-myelinated exons. The first possible scenario that we saw here was that the fibers are coming out of this ventral root and they enter into the sympathetic chain through which one? Through the white ramus communicans, relay in the sympathetic chain, and non-myelinated post-ganglionic sympathetic neurons comes out of gray ramus communicans, use the same spinal nerve, and ultimately goes to supply the smooth muscles of the blood vessel, erector pili muscle, or the sweat glands. Second possible scenario is then where you see that pre-ganglionic sympathetic neuron again entering through what? White ramus communicans, and instead of relaying in the sympathetic chain, the fibers are coming out directly of the sympathetic ganglion, and these nerves are pre-ganglionic sympathetic nerves. Although they are coming out of the chain, but still they are pre-ganglionic sympathetic neurons, and these nerves are specifically called as the splanchnic nerves. You must have read about the splanchnic nerves in thorax also, the greater splanchnic, lesser splanchnic, least splanchnic nerves. And these splanchnic nerves, they will actually go through the diaphragm. They usually pierce the crust of the diaphragm and reach the abdominal region, where they go and relay into the paravertebral ganglion, like celiac, aorticorenal, renal ganglion. So they have that. So sympathetic chain is not the relay center for them. These paravertebral ganglion is the relay center. And from there, the post-ganglionic fiber will reach the stomach. You know, there is one exception which I can tell you here. There's one wonderful exception here. Those pre-ganglionic sympathetic neurons which have to relay in the adrenal medulla, they will bypass the sympathetic chain also and celiac ganglion also. Now, isn't that amazing here? So what I'm trying to say here, if we are done with this, so if I can afford to just look, what I'm saying is those pre-ganglionic neurons, I'm talking about for the adrenal medulla, that's a speciality in the adrenal medulla. Now let's say here's a celiac ganglion. That's a celiac ganglion, and let's say this here is the adrenal medulla. That's the adrenal medulla. So these fibers, they come out of the sympathetic chain without relaying, and they come out of the celiac ganglion also without relaying, and they ultimately go and relay in the adrenal medulla only. So those preganglionic sympathetic neurons, which are specifically for the adrenal medulla, that's one special, you know, one exception that you should remember, that they will come out of the white ramus communicans into the sympathetic chain, no relay there, through the celiac ganglion, no relay there, and they ultimately relay into the ganglions present in the adrenal medulla itself. The next case we talked about is that GSA, general somatic afferent, any general sensation from the body wall, from the skin, from the muscle, that will go and have no connection with the white or the gray ramus communicans. So as you can see, the fibers are going directly through the dorsal root and they're going and relaying into the dorsal horn of the spinal cord. So GSA has nothing to do with the sympathetic chain. Another possible scenario is that when GVA fibers, that is the one which are carrying the general sensation from the viscera, the non-myelinated GVA fibers, they are the one which are entering through the gray ramus communicans. See, you can say they're entering into it, or you can see it in this way, that they are actually entering through white ramus and going out through gray ramus. But because we are talking about sensory, so it's always good to say like that they are entering through gray ramus communicans, and then they will exit through the white ramus communicans to go back to the dorsal root this time, once again having their pseudo-unipolar neurons in the dorsal root ganglia, and finally into the... So that means sympathetic chain is also having, apart from GVE, they're also having GVA type of fibers. GVA type, general sensation from the viscera, non-myelinated exons. And finally, we said that also is a possibility that the preganglionic sympathetic neuron will come through this ventral route, will go into the white ramus communicans, will continue the journey into the sympathetic chain, will go above or below, depends where it has to reach, and might relay into the any respective ganglion like superior cervical or middle cervical. And then from there, the postganglionic fibers will come out through the gray ramus communicans and supply the effector organ, which tells me that the gray ramus communicans will be present everywhere throughout the sympathetic chain, but white ramus communicans is only present in the thoracolumbar region and nowhere else. Right? And that is why we say that injury to T1 region, guys, when we have the injury to the T1 root, why there is a Horner syndrome? The postganglionic fibers to supply the muscles like the dilator pupillae or the sweat glands of the face, they are all supplied by the superior cervical ganglion. Injury is not to superior cervical ganglion. Injury is to what? T1. In Horner syndrome, let's say the injury is to T1 root, but still we can have a sympathetic loss on face because the preganglionic fibers have to come from T1 only. There is no nerve above T1. There is no spinal segment above T1 which will give off the preganglionic sympathetic neurons. That's why in case when we read about the injuries of brachial plexus, in the Klumpke's palsy, when the injury is to the T1 root, it can also lead to the Horner syndrome. That means the preganglionic sympathetic neuron, which are supposed to supply the face, are also disrupted there. So guys, this is about the discussion on the white and the gray ramus communicans. I hope I'm able to make you understand the difference between the two. And it's a very small but it's a wonderful topic, and there could be a lot of MCQs which can be framed from this part. You can leave your feedback, your doubts and everything in the comment box. I will answer your queries also. And if you find this session fruitful, then we can have more of such short sessions on these topics, which are usually not discussed in the class. And I'll also make sure that I'll post these videos in the YouTube channel also. Okay, so goodbye and good night for now.